Hello, this is Hanno Gottschalk from the University of Wuppertal, and I'm going to present the paper Detection of False Positive and False Negative Samples in Semantic Segmentation on the DATE virtual conference. Here you can see a number of co-authors, which are either from University of Wuppertal or from Volkswagen Group Research. What we're talking about is semantic segmentation, which is using a deep neural network to assign to every pixel in a high-resolution image a semantic category. Semantic categories, which come here in the visualization with a certain color, can be cars, or can be info signs, or can be the broadwalk, or can be the street. And it does not, the network does not only assign the category, but it also assigns a probability that a certain category is there. And it does that over 19 categories. So in each pixel, there sits a little probability distribution over 19 categories. And of course, the leading probability is chosen. But as there are these probability arounds, I can ask myself how dispersed these probabilities are over all the possibilities. And if they're not very dispersed, the network seems to be very sure, and we don't have much entropy here, so a little dispersion, but we might also have situations where we have rather high dispersion, like here in this angle, where we also have funny predictions. So this is a so-called heat map, and of course, if I take a less resource-hungry network and I get less good predictions, then I see that I actually also get much more entropy in the heat map. So what you see here is a false positive because it's a prediction of an instance of a category building, which is actually not there because in the ground truth, there's only street here. So that is a false positive, which we should chase down, and that's quite easy because here you also see that it's full of entropy. And likewise, here we have not a complete missing of the broadwalk, but we have here a portion of the broadwalk missed out, and that's also assigned with a lot of entropy here. So we want to predict the prediction. We want to predict the quality of the prediction, and that's measured by the so-called Jaccard index. So we look at the intersection of the prediction with the ground truth. So the ground truth here is larger than the prediction. So we form the intersection of the prediction with the ground truth, and we compare it with the union of the ground truth and the prediction. And this gives us a so-called Jaccard index. So here, this index is zero because this here has no intersection at all with the ground truth. So it's a false positive, or the IOU, the intersection over union, or the Jaccard index is zero. Which, of course, here comes with a lot of entropy. Now we collect all this heat map information over the segments by assigning an average entropy or an average entropy on the boundary or an average entropy in the interior to each of these segments. And these are geometric measures, which is the size of the segment, the length of its boundary, and so on. And this gives us a couple of metrics. These are the distances here between the leading and sub-leading probability or averaged over all the pixels in a given segment. And here are the correlation coefficients between these metrics and the Jaccard index, which is of course not known because for calculating the Jaccard index, you need the ground truth. But for calculating these guys here, you only need the network's prediction. So these are coming up with pretty high correlations, and that gives us hope that we can combine all these metrics into a yet more powerful predictor. That's what you see here. We have two tasks. We either have a classification task of finding a false positive, which is a Jaccard index zero event, or a not zero event if it's not a false positive. So that's a binary classification. And this here is a regression like predicting the amount of the IOU, so the size of the IOU. And we do this with the most simple classifier, which is logistic regression, but we have a sparsifying regularizer sitting here, which we change in strength by controlling the lambda. And we use all 19 available classes as a further matrix, which class is a predicted segment in, and then we predict by the logistic regression this IU zero versus IU non-zero, and we predict the Jaccard index. Now, if the regularization is very strong, none of the parameters is active, and we have a bad model, but then making the regularization weaker or somehow the inverse larger, then we ultimately take off with the first metric, which is the interior metric of the interior average of the difference of the leading and the subleading probability. Then we come up with further metrics from our zoo of metrics. The dashed line here stands for the optimal prediction. And we doing so, we're getting an accuracy for the meta classification task of classifying IUU zero versus IUU non-zero. In other words, classifying whether a given predicted segment is a false positive, which is up to 81% for the exception 65 and 78% for the mobile net V2, whereas guessing probabilities are 68% and 58% for the exception and the mobile net respectively. What you see here is the area under receiver operator curve, so that's pretty much in line with the accuracy values on the test data sets. And what you see here is a meta regression task of predicting the Jaccard index or the IUU, which we adjusted a little bit for that. Please refer to our paper. And then you see that you get an R square of up to 81% for the mobile net. And visualizing that, you have here four panels. The left lower panel gives the ground truth, whereas the right lower panel gives the neural network's prediction. So this here gives the actual quality, and this here gives our predicted quality. And here you see that this is pretty close. The same for the stronger network, essentially the same kind of information. And we can also do that on video data like GTA data, where we have a fully annotated ground truth available. And again, by the similarity of the true quality and the predicted quality, you get a pretty good coincidence of the both. Now, the second thing we want to go into is false negative detection. So false negatives are overlooked instances, like a pedestrian that has not been realized by the ego car driving autonomously. Of course, that's something to avoid. Now, imagine you see something like a unicorn on a photograph. Yeah, a unicorn is a horse with a horn, and that makes up the semantic concept of a unicorn. But our neural networks are not very romantic, so they would say, okay, that looks like a unicorn, but unicorns are extremely rare. And by using this a priori probability that unicorns are very rare, you get the a posteriori probability that this is probably not a unicorn, but you rather decide that this is probably a horse. Contrary to that, you can use the maximum likelihood decision principle, which says just pick the category which semantically fits best to the image you see, and then you stay with the unicorn concept. Applying that to our street data, we see that we get different perceptions as depending whether I use the base maximum a posteriori principle for making an image out of the semantic image out of the probabilities or the maximum likelihood. Like you see here, there's a pedestrian that has been overlooked here with base, or you see many more infoscans because pedestrians and infoscans pixel this are rare categories. Putting this into instances, we see here instances of different sizes, and you see the overlooked instances by the maximum likelihood principle or the Bayes principle. So these are pedestrians overlooked in a data set of 20,000 things, and this is here the relative amount. So you roughly overlook half as many instances of the category pedestrian if you use maximum likelihood instead of Bayes. Of course, that again comes at the cost of many more false positives. This is here the same thing visualized. So over 20,000 images, these are all the overlooked instances for the Bayes, and these are overlooked instances for the maximum likelihood decision principle. You find much more detail in our papers, and we hope you look into them, and of course we hope you read our paper from the base from the proceedings of DATE. So thank you for following this, and I wish you a nice virtual conference.